So, this is the first part of our lecture on trade and comparative advantage. And we're going to go ahead and start with a very simple model. We're going to have two countries and two goods. And our first country is going to be Argentina. And Argentina is going to have 12 workers. We could think of that as 12 million workers. And Argentina's workers can work in one of two industries. We either have a pork industry or a wine industry. And Argentina is going to initially split its workers equally between the two industries so that they can have some things to eat and some things to drink. So they're going to take half of their 12 million workers. So they're going to take six workers. Each produces 15 pork. That gets us 90 pork. Then they're going to take the other half of their 12 workers and have them produce five wine each, and that gets us to 30 wine. But obviously, that's not the only way we could split up the workers. We could put all 12 workers into wine, have them produce five wine each, and get 12 times five, or 60 wine, but that would leave us with zero pork. Or we could take all 12 workers and put them in the pork industry, have them produce 15 pork each, and that would get us 180 pork. But then we would have zero wine. So either of these two endpoints represents extreme and total specialization in one industry. This red point that's halfway between the two of them represents splitting our labor force equally between the two industries. And if we were sort of here, we would have three quarters of our labor force in wine, roughly, and one quarter in pork. Here would be the other way around. And so any of these points along this line is a possible way of splitting up our labor force and getting a different mix of the two goods. So this line, what we call the production possibilities frontier, represents a sort of menu of choices, and we can select to be at one point or another on the line, depending on how we split up our labor force. And notice our labor force is almost like a kind of currency that we can devote to purchasing the two different goods by producing them. Consequently, we can also think about the cost of producing wine is the fact that we have to take workers out of the pork industry and put them into the wine industry. And in doing that, we decrease the amount of pork that we get and we increase the amount of wine that we get. And that gets us to our next slide, thinking about the actual rate of trade-offs here. So, if Argentina uses one less worker to produce pork and one more worker to produce wine, how much pork will it lose and how much wine will it gain? Well, we look at these numbers right here to figure that out here. In particular, for this one, we could go, well, they lose 15 tons of pork and gain 5 tons of wine. And that tells us something about the rate of trade-offs between the two different goods. We could then go ahead and figure out what that is per ton of wine, and that gets us to this question right here. What is Argentina's opportunity cost of producing 1 ton of wine in terms of pork? We could also turn that around. Suppose that instead of cutting back on pork production and increasing wine production, Argentina decided it wanted to cut back on wine production and increase pork production. Well, how much wine would Argentina have to give up per ton of pork? That's the second half of this question number two in this slide. So that is how we measure the trade-offs. We measure the trade-offs usually in an opportunity cost sense. How much of one good would I have to give up to get some of the other? Our second country in this simple model here is going to be Brazil. And Brazil, we're going to have a slightly larger labor force. Instead of 12 million workers, we're going to have 30 million workers. And workers in Brazil have a different level of productivity. Each Brazilian worker can produce 12 tons of pork or 2 tons of wine. And we're going to assume that at first, before the two countries start specializing and trading with each other, Brazil splits its labor force equally between the two industries so that it can have something to eat and something to drink. So it takes half of its 30 million workers and puts them into the pork industry, Half of that, 30, would be 15. Each of the workers produces 12 tons of pork. And so Brazil gets 12 times 15 equals 180 pork. Then it takes half of its 30 million workers and puts them into the wine industry. So it takes 15 workers, each produces 2 tons of wine, so it gets 2 times 15, or 30 wine. And again, we can draw a picture here, the production possibilities frontier. We're assuming that Brazil initially splits its labor force equally between the two countries, between the two goods. But it could have put all 30 workers into wine, and they would produce 2 wine each, and that would give us 60 wine, but 0 pork. Or it could take all 30 of its workers and put them into pork, and each produces 12 each, and so it would have 12 times 30, or 360 pork, but then it would have 0 wine. And again, with different combinations of labor force and the different goods, we could end up, say, 90% of our labor force in wine would put us up about here, and 90% of our labor force in pork would put us here. And as we rearrange our labor force between the two different goods, we're moving along this line. Again, we get to pick one point on the line. We might change it later, but it's a menu of choices, and we can only choose to do one or the other. We can't choose to have 360 pork and 60 wine, because to produce 360 pork would require all 30 of our workers, and that would leave none left over for producing wine. Same as before, we can think about what are Brazil's trade-offs for the two different goods. So if Brazil uses one less worker to produce pork and one more worker to produce wine, how much pork will it lose and how much wine will it gain? And then we can use that information to figure out what Brazil's opportunity cost of producing one ton of wine is. How much pork, that is, does Brazil give up per ton of wine? On the other side of that, the reciprocal of that, what is Brazil's opportunity cost of producing one ton of pork in terms of wine it's sacrificed? Notice we now have two different ways of thinking about the costs of production. We could think in terms of the input costs required to produce a unit of output. We could think of the hours of work per ton of wine, or the amount of work per ton of wine. So if a Brazilian worker produces 2 tons of wine in a year, then it must have taken him about half a year to produce 1 ton of wine. Or we could think about the opportunity cost of sacrificing one good for another. How much pork do we have to give up per ton of wine? The first way of thinking about costs is related to the idea of the absolute advantage. Which country has the absolute advantage in a certain good? In particular, to stay consistent with the way I've just described it, whichever country or producer produces more output per unit of input, that is, more pork per year of labor, say for instance, has the absolute advantage in producing that good. We could also think about which country requires a smaller amount of inputs to produce a certain amount of output. And they're both the same, because notice, if I produce 5 of something per hour, then I have a time cost of 1/5 of an hour, or 12 minutes per unit. Whereas if you produce 10 of something an hour, you have more output per hour, then you only required 6 minutes per widget. So if you have more output per hour, that means it takes you less time per unit. And it's sort of worth noticing, and it'll keep on coming back, that productivity and costs are inversely related. If you're highly productive, then you have a low time cost to do something. Or if you have a high output per acre in terms of crops, that means you don't need much land. You have a low cost in terms of land needed to produce a given amount of crops. So that's how we measure absolute advantage. So sometimes there are gains from trade just because different countries have different strengths, and it's as simple as that. So there's a reason why redwood trees are grown on the North Coast, and there's a reason why oil is pumped out of Saudi Arabia, and that the two countries or two regions trade with each other. It would be really hard to raise redwood trees in Saudi Arabia, and there just isn't that much north oil on the North Coast, although we did have petroleum for a while. For the application here, in this example here, which country has the absolute advantage in producing pork, if either, and which country has the absolute advantage in producing wine, if either? And that's going to go ahead and pause us here for this lesson.